The following movie has been rated PG by the Motion Picture Association of America. Parental guidance is suggested.
The point is that we have to start sitting down with one another again and talking. Parents, start taking an active role in your child's dating game, okay? They have to come to you first. And we allow our daughters to let their boyfriends disrespect them and us. Now, my baby girl is only 4. But when she's 18 and she starts dating, if a brother pulls up in front of my house and honks the horn instead of getting out and coming in to speak to me, he'll never see my daughter again. But mom, children learn by what they see, not by what you tell them. Don't tell it to demand respect if you ain't demanding it. You got somebody knocking you upside your head, sleeping with the whole neighborhood, and he's still in your bed. She's going to become you in 20 years if you don't do something about it right now.
I would like to now introduce someone who had a very deep vision. He is an intelligent, generous, loving, caring, supportive man. Come on out, Keith.
Thank y'all very much. Thank you very much. No, it's not easy. Hopefully we're gonna make a change. We're gonna change the court system. We're going to change that the way men think and the way that women think, and we're going to stop disrespecting each other. That's the main thing, respect.
A man is going to be a man, mm-hmm. And I'm going to be me. I can't be like them. I don't want to be like them. You know, me and my kid's father gets along. I'll be friends with them. No use hating them. If they working, they support my kids. If they don't, they don't. Only problem I have is when they don't come get them when they say they're going to come get them.
And what's your reaction then?
I don't even react. I'll be like, whatever.
Okay.
Whatever.
Okay. I can't let it hurt me, you know, because if it hurts me, then it's going to hurt my child even more. If they see me standing strong, then they'll stay strong. You can't let no man pull you down because of what they do.
No, you cannot.
I take my daughter out when the dad don't come. I take her someplace myself.
Well, how do you explain it to your kids?
I just tell her, that's him. You have to accept him for who he is. And when he come along, he come along. You know, men are going to be men. That's how I was raised. I don't know about anybody else.
Did you ever talk to them about how they feel about him not?
It's so hard when they hurt. And they come to you and they crying when their dad don't come get them.
It is.
I comfort her. I comfort my son when he was younger. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's the only thing you can do is comfort them and make them feel good and tell them it's going to be all right. Because those days are going to go on until they get old enough to tell their dad where to go.
What's your biggest issue with your children's father?
Not accepting responsibility.
Okay, what do you mean?
Not accepting responsibility. Well, my oldest son is 19, so I really don't have to worry about him. But my youngest daughter, financially, he's not supportive at all.
And how do you try to deal with that?
I don't, because you can't make somebody do something that you want them to do.
That's true. How does your child feel about that?
She loves him to death.
And how does that make you feel with him not being as supportive as you would like him to be?
It's not really about how I feel. It's about my daughter. So I have to accept it.
You said that you wish that your child's father would accept responsibility. Does that mean he's not paying support at all, or would he, or not?
No.
Now, you said that you've learned to accept that, but the one thing that I don't think you understand that I have a problem with that is that child support isn't for you, it's for the child. And you've come to accept it, but the child isn't old enough to accept it.
But you can't get anything from somebody that's not willing to give. My case has been in court for 7 years, and I've received child support one time.
Well, I mean, you have to use the system the way it is. We just saw a video that somebody said, like, what's going to happen if I don't pay? You know, I'm going to get my bench warrant and I'm going to get locked up. He should be locked up if he's not taking care of
his
child.
To tell the courts that, because I can only go down and petition the courts, but whatever happens after that is out of my hands. I can't go on the rest of my life being angry. I have to move on.
Well, let's ask the judge.
Well, I think the key that we just started talking about was the fact that the child support is supposed to be for the child, but clearly the mother needs to spend the money for the child. The problem requires in our system that the mother let the court know that she wants her case continued. You cannot give up on those fathers and give them the easy out. Now, fortunately, today the computers are running like cash registers. So if you've taken that father down, the question becomes, do you know if he's got some sort of income so that you can tell the court that he's making money either under the table, beside the table, or in the form of a job?
Well, if the system is set up where they, if they have an income tax check and they're not paying support, is set up, that system doesn't really work, because I found out that my daughter's father was working, and automatically the deduction should have been taken from him. His wages should have been garnished, and I didn't know anything about it.
Well, was he working under the table? That's the question. You and I know that many of these men...
Wages, not under the table, okay, paycheck.
Then if he had a paycheck... All you have to do, did you notify the court that he was working?
I did not know.
You didn't know he was working?
No.
Okay, but when did you learn he was working, though?
After he was working for 6 months.
Okay, then that's when you should convey that information to the court so that they can go to his employer and attach his wages. But if a man doesn't tell his employer, and the only way he can tell his employer is to take his order there and say, hey, deduct it out of my wages, that's the only way the court would be able to know that he is working.
From my understanding, the way that it works is once the information is in the system, because no one is going to be honest and say, hey, I'm working, take money out of my check.
No, that's not true. There are a lot of fathers who are willing to accept their responsibility.
Yes, that's true. I'm speaking in my case. Okay. That's not true for everyone.
Of course not. But the point is, the court can work with you. If you work with the court, if you know he is working, then you have to let the court know that he is now working, and then they can use his Social Security number and go get him. But you should know that the courts can go after his income tax return. That's the only way they're going to be able to get him if you don't tell them and have him brought back before the court. They will get his income tax information.
Now, I know I'm sitting up here with judges and attorneys, but being that I'm from the hood and I may be educated, check it out. This is something illegal, but if you really want to find out who's getting paid what, if you know where their mama lives, if you know where their brother lives, on trash day, you pick up their trash. You get all the information. I'm sorry. But if you want to know what folks are doing, pick up their trash on trash day. You get all the information. You know who's working for who.
All the negative things that other kids say about you, all the things kids try to make you do and don't do, you have to be your own leader. You cannot be a follower. No one is better than the other, and you cannot raise your kids to think that one is better than the other, because they're not. They're all individuals, and they have to be raised that way and be strong.
We need to think about the men that we choose in our lives and how they're going to play a part in our children's lives.
you shouldn't have to have the courts tell us to take care of our babies.
Baby mom found out that you got a girlfriend, you can't see your kids, or you can't get your kids and take them with you.
You must find a way to connect with your lady.
It's a struggle, it's a fight, don't get it twisted. It's a lot easier to do this and do that than it is to try to find this job, trying to find that job, or trying to do right by your kid or do right by your baby moms. However the situation may be, it's a struggle.
I wish they would take care of these babies. Okay. And I wish the young girls would wake up and get themselves together.
I mean, it takes two, it didn't take one.
His mind wasn't where I was, so I dumped him. And he still love me, but he be trying to get back, but I don't be trying to get back no more.
So you really think the system worked for you?
It's not meant to work for you. You know what I'm saying? It's not meant to work for us at all. It's set up for women, period.
From a female perspective, what would you think that the females need to do to try to stop running the men off or chasing them off?
Stop being so harsh with them. Every man is not the same. All men are not going to run away from their responsibilities.
It's about the children. We have to save our children. We got to stop fighting. We got to stop bickering. We got to stop the jealousy. We got to stop the envy. We got to stop the hatred. All of those are self-destructive methods.
And to all my young sisters, I would like to say, I mean, just get to know your people. Get to know your people before you lay down with them. You know what I mean? Get to know their background, their history.
But you can't always blame the female. Y'all say because we argue, y'all say because we pest, you say because we always whine. No, but y'all be out in the street, they be out in the street with the next woman doing other things, thinking it ain't gonna happen.
You look at what the child needs, and you both work together on that, and then you deal with your stuff as a secondary issue.
Not all of us like are deadbeat dads. Most of us do the right thing for the right reason.
People don't grow up saying, I wish I'm going to be a deadbeat dad when I grow up.
But a lot of us, you know, we do our job, you know. It's just like, you know, when you're trying to provide for them, they always want more than what you could get, or then they want you to go out and do more than what you could do.
Take me off that court, I mean, it got me going to court. If I don't pay that money, I'm going to have to, you know, end up getting a bench warrant. I'm going to pay the money and take care of all y'all at the same time.
We're going to get these brothers out the court, and we're going to let them stand on their own 2 feet and handle their responsibility. And that's what we're going to try to do. So let's make it happen. Walk Down Entertainment right here in Child Support Court headquarters. Holla.
The real deal on the mother.
Please.
She had him for 6 months. I went to pick him up to go take him to my mother before Christmas. And everything was in the bag. Footprints, everything. And my mother told me, I got these kids. That's the real deal.
Let's give a round of applause for grandmothers. It's good to have grandma in the house.
No. We want to know, see, the real deal. Is she on drugs? Did she go to prison? Is she a lesbian? Come on, what's the real deal?
None of that.
So then, what's wrong? Was your choice incorrect?
Excuse me?
Was your choice incorrect?
Was my choice what?
Incorrect.
Incorrect?
Because, see, wait a minute. Mothers just don't walk away from their children. That's not an eight.
Listen. After today, you'll know that mothers do it.
Nah, brother. No, but I understand that that's a practice, but the behavior has a reasoning to it. The behavior has a reasoning to it.
When I finally talk to the mother, I'll definitely let you know.
Okay, there you go.
I wanted to make two quick comments. One, in the father's defense, I think we need to be careful not to brutalize a single male parent. Because he is one. Because I think that if that was a female sitting there who said the father walked out, we probably wouldn't have had any questions at all. The other point that I would like to make as a psychologist is the human mind and consciousness is so complex that you can never really know when someone's gonna pack up and walk out. And with that, I would say that we do need to get the young ladies some help. I'm not sure of the age, but you have to be very sensitive with that. You don't talk to a 4 or 5 year old specifically about the reasons why mom is not there. Because if you mess with that mind too early, you might break something in it, can't fix it later, and the ladies grow up to become lesbians because unfortunately, in our community, we have come to believe that homosexuality and lesbianism, okay, are in some way not related to the child's development. Some are of the opinion that there's a gene that predisposes children to be that way, but they haven't found it. And what you need to understand is that a female child grows up hating mother or mother's absence, she may then start hating all women and cease wanting to be one herself.
Very well put, Dr. Johnson.
And with your sons, and this is why it's so important that we do not reduce fatherhood or motherhood to a check. The reason why is this: even if he don't pay, even if she don't pay, them first 5 years of life are so important that you cannot afford to have a parent not there over some money. If you need to take them, you take them, but if you can hold off until they're 7 or 8, please do so. Because when you pull them into court, it's going to affect the relationship that the father has with you as mom, and that's going to affect the relationship that daddy has with child. And if his father isn't in his life, he may grow up hating men and may decide he wants to be a woman. Thank you.
Very well put. Let's give a round of applause. Mr. Johnson, very well put, Mr. Johnson.
She asks questions. F7 children are very aware of what goes on.
Yes,
you know,
they are.
And she sees what goes on. You know, at one time, you know, when the mother was talking negative about the father, which they do, you know, when children grow older, they realize, like, some of that was untrue. You know what I mean? I'm getting mixed signals because when I'm with my father, he don't seem to be the guy that my mom portrayed him to be. You know what I mean?
Okay.
And when she asks questions, I try to be open and honest as possible without assassinating her mother's character. You know what I mean? I always tell her to love and respect and honor her mother. You know, the God I serve is a good God and he's a forgiving God. And like with that, I try to instill in her, you know what I mean? So when she asks questions about why we're not together, I just let her know.
Which
your
is?
Your mother has her own life and I have my life, but we're your parents, you know what I mean? Always respect her, you know what I mean? That's the bottom line.
It's a good attitude to have.
I have to ask if I can ask the question about the support. Are you paying support for all three of those children?
Sure. No. I'm paying child support for my youngest. My other two, one is the oldest is 28, you know, and she made me a grandfather, which I'm happy to be. And I have a 16-year-old, which I played an intricate part in her life, and I constantly give her when she needs. And, you know, me and her mother has a rapport where she didn't have to. Either my oldest daughter, they never took me to child support because I was there. You know, I always worked, and I always was a provider. You know, I was never a deadbeat dad. With my 7-year-old, I paid child support because I was working, and when she was born, from the day she was born, I was taken care of. And now that I'm unable to work, I'm on disability now, they give you a 3-year review every 3 years with the child, and we elected to stop paying child support until my disability start because I'm not working and I don't have any income coming in now.
Now since you have three girls by three different women,
mm-hmm.
Do they call each other half-sisters, or do they call each other, are
they
all
they
sisters?
Call each other sisters. I raise them to let them know that no matter what, separate mothers, you're still biological sisters. You give the same love that you have for your other sisters and brothers. The way you love me and your mother, love your sister the same way.
Because I'm actually just wondering, how does it come about that when a woman has children, they're children, but when the father has children, they become my half-brother, my half-sister? That's why I asked that question.
Well, that becomes because, you know, some people are ignorant to the fact that they don't make that known to the child. You know what I mean? See, the teaching starts in the house. You know what I mean? If you instill in your child the significance of their brother and sister, there is no time to have a half brother, a half sister. You know what I mean? Did we make half a baby?
Oh. Okay, Brother Bassett. Mr. Henderson.
I actually wanted to commend both of the fathers for what you're doing, particularly the fact that you don't attack or condemn the opposite parent. And the reason why that's so important, when parents attack each other, in their selfishness, they fail to realize that you're not only attacking the opposite parent, you're attacking the child. And children who come from households where their parents are constantly fighting and degrading one another grow up to have the lowest levels of self-esteem and the highest levels of suicide. Because when you attack that opposite sex parent, you're attacking part of the child. So if one parent is attacking and the other parent is not, then the child hates half of themselves. But when both parents are attacking one another, the child learns to hate their complete self. And the other thing that I wanted to say was your daughters in the long run are going to be well served when they grow up and it's time to choose a mate. Their chances of success in marriage are going to be so much higher. Because one thing we don't understand is that the relationship that a child forms with the opposite sex parent serves as a blueprint for every relationship they have with an opposite sex person in their lives. And sometimes mom and sometimes dad, we mess up that blueprint by condemning it and crippling it, so when the daughter grows up, she don't think that no man could ever satisfy her needs and desires because mom said that daddy was no good. And when she's older and can't find nobody, we look at the child and say, well, something wrong with you. No, all psychopathology originates in the family system. So if you're looking for the cause, go home.
I would like to bring out Omar Samad.
Welcome, Omar. Omar. Omar Samad.
You have a daughter, is that right?
Yes.
And how old is she?
She is presently 10 months.
10 months?
Yes.
Do you have any other children?
I have 12 others.
Okay. How fast can you say all of their names?
I've never practiced.
All right, well, just give us all of their names then.
Khalili, Dumar, Amar, excuse me, Amir, Amin, Divine Earth, Hadia, and Josette.
It's more?
County. Who'd I leave out?
Wow, that's bad, brother. That's bad.
I didn't know you guys are counting. Okay, let's see. Nicole and Amir.
Okay. So how many is that?
Hey, that's it, okay?
That's it?
Okay. Okay, and the ages range from the oldest is?
The oldest is 37.
And your youngest
and
is
the youngest
10?
Is 10 months, yes.
Okay, are you together with the mother of your 10-month-old?
No, I'm not. We're currently in custody court.
Okay, and how long has that been going on?
That's been going on since February.
Okay, and what are the issues that you are facing with that?
This particular parent is bipolar. So there's a couple different issues taking place with this. She feels that the child should be with her because of her other child. She wants to keep the two girls together. My issue is that I am the positive and the permanent parent, and that I am the one who should have the child with me.
Okay, and do you currently have the child with you now?
No, I do not.
And that's why you're going to court for full custody?
Yes.
Okay. Do we have any questions for him?
I have a quick comment. Am I talking too much?
Oh, brother, you giving up that wisdom. You giving up the wisdom, brother. That's what we're here for.
As a psychologist, one thing that bothers me sometimes is how we allow psychological diagnoses to control the relationship we have with the other parent. I want you to understand that psychological diagnoses are tools of social control. If we go back 100 years ago, when some of our ancestors were in chains, there was a diagnosis called drapetitude, and it said that a slave who had a desire to run away from his master had drapetitude, and the cure for it was not Ritalin, but it was to whip the living hell out of the slave. The point that I'm trying to make is we got to be careful the way we throw around bipolar and ADHD and all this other stuff. And for you ADHD people, ADHD has very little to do with hyperactivity. It has a whole lot to do with the sugar that you're feeding them, breakfast, lunch, and dinner, the schools that ain't got gym class or recess, and the other thing it has to do with is a lack of parental involvement. 95% of all black boys diagnosed as ADHD do not have a father figure in their life. Now, we know that from the beginning of time, when a child does not get the proper attention from home, they go to school trying to make up for it. 20 years ago, it wasn't ADHD. Your father or mother who had control of you would come up to the school and give you a good old whipping. But today, because we no longer know how to be parents to our children, we go to other people asking them to solve the problem. They solve it, get rich, and then your child is strung out on drugs that are just as addictive as crack and speed.
Very well, brother.
Yeah, okay.
You say yeah, huh? You say that like that's a problem there, Mr. Henderson?
Because I'm a feel for the brother only because of being a social worker. And when a man has to deal with something that he knows nothing about, and when he deals with a woman that he sees that he used to behave in one way, and she changes, and he doesn't know what to do. I mean, and then sometimes that kind of throws him off, and he wants to protect his child. And so it may be difficult for him to see what the woman is going through. So therapist, if you're gonna talk about bipolar, I mean, and I hear you talking from nutrition, but for a man to understand that there's a woman, and see, bipolar is kind of new to us because we thought that she's crazy. You know, so if you're going to talk about bipolar, let them know what to expect from it. I mean, because for the next man who deals with a woman who has bipolar, he needs to know how to see it, how he deal with it, and what are his resources. Therapist.
Okay.
I'd like to make a statement.
Okay. This ain't a battle.
This brother here was definitely correct. When I first got with this young lady, I knew she was bipolar, but had no idea what bipolar was. I had to live with it for 2.5 years to experience what bipolar was. Manic on one end, depressive on the other, and constantly swinging in the middle. On drugs, well, I won't say drugs, I'll say on the medication she was taking. When she stopped taking the medication, it went totally another way. Then other issues came in, and that's when it became, I need to take custody.
What other issues?
Other issues of she stating she wanted to kill herself and the children.
That was deep.
When I went to her therapist and asked her therapist what to do, she said she's over 21, she can't make her take the pills. When I went to my son, who's a social worker, he suggested call DHS, which was the last thing I wanted to do.
Yeah.
When I called DHS, they got right on it with a crisis team. That night, they came out, took her off her job, took the children from the daycare, took her home, gave her a little therapy, talked to her a little bit. But what ended up happening was she had to 302 herself. She had to commit herself to a mental institution. I had to take my daughter. The other daughter went with the mother, with the mother's mother, the grandmother.
Okay.
And I kept my daughter until she came out of the mental institution. But this was her second stay in a mental institution, and I never knew the first one. Until I went to the mental institution visiting the second one, I was told about the first one.
Okay. Well, y'all know Mr. Lonnie's an attorney and Ms. Patricia's an attorney. So if y'all have any legal issues, those are the two you directed to, because we can't help you with that one.
Just a quick question, sir. You had indicated that the second time your child's mother had gone, had 302'd herself and you had custody of your child.
Yes.
What did you do to go up to the court? I mean, when you went to court, when did you go to court to get custody of your child?
I went to court when she first went in. When she first 302'd herself that following Monday, right, DHS, the supervisor suggested for me to go to court and file for custody.
Now, was that an emergency custody order, or you filed just a petition? Well, not just a petition, but you filed a petition for custody.
A petition for custody and the emergency order, I didn't think it was right for me to do the emergency order, because I actually wasn't trying to take her then. But as time went on, I started finding out that maybe I should take this child altogether.
Now, you indicated that you didn't feel like you should have taken her then. However, you did have some knowledge prior to that the mother was not right psychologically, and that your child could have been in some type of danger the potential for danger. So why didn't you think that it was an emergency and that you did not think that it was the right time to take your child?
Well, I had dealt with her about 11 months off the medication. And dealing with her was really a hard problem. I mean, it was just horrendous. When I felt that things got worse with when she made the statement she was going to kill herself and the children. Up until that point, I dealt with everything. I don't think, and I don't really want to say this, but if you want to do something to yourself, not a problem. Not the children.
Let me ask you a question. How long you were seeing her prior to you having a relationship with her?
I knew her 2.5 years.
So in this 2.5 years, you never knew she was bipolar?
Yes, I'm saying now, when I first met her, I knew she was bipolar.
So you actually knew what you was getting yourself into?
Never had an idea.
No, he didn't know. He didn't know what
never
he was getting
had an idea what bipolar was.
Okay.
You need to experience bipolar. It's not something you read about in a book. You need to experience it.
I think my definition would be just people uneducated and how they was brought up as far as their behavior wise.
I agree. Could I chime in again?
Briefly? Sure.
Of course.
One thing you have to know about all psychological diagnoses, because we're hung on this bipolar, the diagnosis is only as good as the clinician who makes it. Psychology is highly subjective. That means what one psychologist says is bipolar, another one says is an adjustment disorder, someone else calls schizophrenia, and someone else says it's a personality disorder. And I say that not to discount the fact that you had to live with it, because the point that I'm trying to make is broader than just your particular situation. But something else you have to understand, whenever you commit yourself, whether it's a mental health clinic, a hospital, get your kids evaluated for so-called ADHD. In order for the evaluating clinician to get paid from the HMO, they must diagnose something or you don't get paid. So if you go in there asking, is something wrong with me? The answer is yes, because I won't get a reimbursement. Exactly. Second point, with the drugs are making the psychopathology worse. Ritalin, Paxil, Zoloft, Strattera, they are linked to depression,
suicide, homicide, diabetes, blindness, stroke, schizophrenia, and everything else. You say they tried to make her take the drugs. I would say take her the hell off the drugs, because it's the drugs that's making the situation worse.
Well,
what advice would you...
respect to what you say may be correct, but until you live with it, you have to live with this. This is not something you read about in a book. Living with it, have you ever lived with a person like that? See, I've lived with this lady, and I've seen her on and off the drug. Off the drug, it was almost impossible. I mean, I put up with this for like about 11 months off the drug.
Right.
And now that she's back on the drug, we can deal. I don't have a problem. I still have a few issues every now and then, but basically we can deal.
Right. And I'm not debating with you, good brother, but if a crack addict is on crack and they ain't had none, and you need them to function in your house, and you go get them some, are you solving the problem? Hell no. And something else you need to know, most clinical trials, okay, on bipolar, depression, most of the major disorders, clearly show that psychotherapy is more effective than the drug. So why don't we give them therapy as opposed to the drug? You know why? Because the HMOs don't like to reimburse for therapy. It might take too long, so they just give them a few pills to get them out the office. That's not going against you. Just some extra information about that situation.
She's doing both. She's going to therapy and taking the drugs.
But also, okay, have you ever heard of Skitzen? You know what Skitzen is?
Yes.
Well then, being bipolar in your house, she's Skitzen every day, right? Almost.
To an extent, yes.
Now the question that, I'm just saying, this how it looks from outside, okay. Now, but I'm thinking that if you want him to go get psychotherapy, where should he go get it from?
When you contact an HMO, right, most of the time they're going to refer you to a psychologist who will refer you to a psychiatrist. Most of the times they'll refer you directly to a psychiatrist, because a psychiatrist is a medical doctor. A psychologist is not. In order to get therapy, you have to ask for it. They're not going to willingly allow it, because the clinician determines how long the course of therapy can be. And based on how much they charge per session, it can end up coming up to be more money than the drug would be. And that's my concern. See, drugs don't solve problems. Not the ones that you get on the corner or the ones you get from the psychiatrist. All they do is suppress the symptoms. They suppress the symptoms. And when you stop taking a drug, whether it's a crack addict or a boy strung out on Ritalin, the symptoms come back but 20 times worse. The problem did not originate with drugs. It originated with a disturbance in that family unit. So find out what the ingredients are in the house that's contributing to the psychopathology and deal with that. It's so much easier to go to the crack man. It takes a lot of time to be able to sit down and work through issues. So all I'm saying is, not to attack you, all I'm saying is we got to look more at the variables in the house that could be contributing to the problem and work with that.
There's two issues that you stated that were correct. Mm-hmm. One is it did come from the house. The parent was the same way, part of the issue. The other issue is that while she was in the institution, because of the costs, they couldn't keep her long enough.
Exactly.
And her therapist said she actually should have stayed longer. Mm-hmm. But because of costs, she couldn't stay as long as she needed to.
Exactly. And one thing I just want to add to that, and I'm going to let you guys get back. I'm sorry. Psychology. Remember this one thing. The word psychology is a Greek word. Psyche stands for mind. But the Greeks actually stole the word from ancient Africa. And in Africa, psyche meant soul and spirit. And the point that I'm trying to make is the reason why we're diagnosed so much with all these disabilities and mental disorders is because there's something wrong with the soul and you got to make it right. And I'm not saying, okay, that you got to be of a certain religion, but you live and exist based on spirit, not based on mind, okay? And what we have to do is be able to harmonize our mind with our spirit, with our outside environment.
You don't let some materialistic doctor come in and try to fix something that they don't even know about in the first place. If you take care of that spirit, all else will be well. And that's why in the black community, reverends and pastors who have never went to school for psychology have cured more psychopathology than most mental health practitioners put together, because they understand it's spirit, not mind.
What's your name, please?
Emily Williams. Dr. Emily Williams. I have a question for, I'm not sure of his name, that has the 10-month-old. And I understand you said you knew this woman for 2 years. You lived with her or was aware that she was off her medicines for 11 months. So somewhere in between, you conceived this child with her, knowing her condition. Did you not have time to research what bipolar meant? And did you not have time to do whatever it takes to protect yourself so that you would not have a child with this woman?
Very good question. I'll tell you what happened.
That's it.
Well, you need to hear the truth. Here's what happened. In the beginning, my issue was cover, which is what I've done. As the relationship became a little more serious, at the end of the second year, it became uncover, because I was told, well, I'm using Depo now. Myself believing this, and I still think that she probably was. I'm sort of thinking that Depo was based on body weight. And from the body weight, maybe she wasn't giving it enough. Now, I don't know. This is what I'm told. But I uncovered. Maybe I was fooled. But apparently, I had to be able to afford being fooled.
Okay.
My second question is for number one, Basile, who has the twin girls. I have a problem with somewhere, I mean, again, a problem with men and women is the lack of communication. And I've heard that you have not been able to communicate. I don't know why, but I would think you should make an effort. I mean, when she came to your mother with these twins at 6 months and said, they're yours, I don't know, I would have went over and I would have tracked her down and I would have said, Mom, you watch these two kids for me while I come back. Or somewhere between, I mean, how come you cannot or communicate with the mother of this child?
I'm handling my business. I'm not focused on her.
I like that answer, bro. That's your answer?
But that's not handling your business. There has to be some kind of communication between the mother of your children and you.
You know, but like I said, before he leaves today, I'm going to get him involved with a male parenting group. And the brother's young. So we may have expectations that we may think that he's not meeting. But be confident in us. I think that a lot of us who work in this profession, we're going to move him from where he is to where he needs to be.
Good. Very good, brother. We're going to get you to the right people there.
My name is Videla, and my question is to anybody. I'd like to know what happened to the communication, for real. Because, like, before you can even have a relationship, you have to have communication. And like my thing is like, in order for you to have a relationship, we have to know each other. How do you know if you are compatible? You know, and like my thing is Planned Parenthood. What happened to that? Planned Parenthood. You have to plan these things. You know, and that's my question. My question is, anybody can answer that, anybody up there. You know, like the fact that, you know, having a family and sticking together, that's what it's supposed to be all about, a family. Having a child, just having a child, but having a family. That's my question.
I have a brief comment to that. Number one, I would like us to use family planning instead of Planned Parenthood. And the reason I say that is when you look into the history of Planned Parenthood, you'll find that it was started by a woman in New York City by the name of Margaret Sanger. Margaret Sanger was a part of the eugenics movement from which psychology and education both come. Eugenics movement was based upon scientific racism, about finding a justification for the extermination of the African race. Planned Parenthood was developed to reduce the birth rate of black babies in the United States of America. So let's not use Planned Parenthood. Yes, let's use family planning. The question you asked was a good one. And when you look in our history, I think you'll find a cure. And historically, before we ever got married, if a son was looking for a wife, she had to get the stamp of approval from mom. If a daughter was looking for a husband, she had to get the stamp of approval from dad. The problem in our community is we allow children with no experience, who don't know a damn thing, to go out and decide who they're going to spend the rest of their life with. We don't make them invite them over for dinner. We don't sit them down for an interview. We go on interviews for jobs that we work for a couple months or a couple years, but here it is, our child about to make the biggest decision of their life, and we don't have no part in it. We believe in this individualism. Go out on your own and go find you a mate. And it's destroying our communities. But part of that problem has to do with the erosion of the family unit itself. How many of us sit down at night and have dinner with our children and our families? In case you don't know, McDonald's, Burger King, Checkers, KFC
is not
blew good. Up in the past 20 years because the black family got destroyed. You would not have so many Chinese and Korean corner stores if you would sit down and have dinner with one another. But because you hate one another, they can sell you stale chicken wings and french fries and all that garbage that's clogging up your arteries and veins. So what we have to do is start sitting down. It's not racist, because to have racism, you gotta have power, and we ain't got none. But the point is that we have to start sitting down with one another again and talking. Parents, start taking an active role in your child's dating game, okay? They have to come to you first. And we allow our daughters to let their boyfriends disrespect them and us. Now, my baby girl is only 4, but when she's 18 and she starts dating, if a brother pulls up in front of my house and honks the horn instead of getting out and coming in to speak to me, he'll never see my daughter again. But mom, children learn by what they see, not by what you tell them. Don't tell her to demand respect if you ain't demanding it. You got somebody knocking you upside your head, sleeping with the whole neighborhood, and he's still in your bed. She's going to become you in 20 years if you don't do something about it right now.
No one is ever defeated until you accept defeat as reality. And once you accept defeat as reality, it becomes a state of mind. You think you lost, you will definitely lose.
Two sick people can't make a healthy family.
You need to experience bipolar. It's not something you read about in a book. You need to experience it.
These are the great people that made the way for us. They worked hard. They died. Some of them died for y'all. Put a strong desire behind your action, and you could be whatever or whoever you want to be.
Yeah, I think at this point we ought to recognize that every relationship is unique. The only thing constant in it is you and me. And the courts don't have the solution to all of these problems, nor should we expect them to have the solution to the problems. It seems to me that those other things that we've been alluding to, in other words, the principles, the religious faith that we may have, and the values that we inherited from the people that raised us in this life, are the factors that have to come into play, and those are the ones that we have to put our beliefs in, and our attempts to try to raise our children must be pursuant to those standards. Otherwise, we have something that everyone's alluded to here, and it's called the system. And the system is just that. It's a process that we as a community have created because things aren't perfect amongst people. And if we're dealing with the imperfections of people, we're therefore dealing with a system that in and of itself is going to have imperfections. So I say all of that to simply say that if we value ourselves, then we have to value our children. And in valuing our children, we are in essence saying that we ourselves are of some import. And if we're of some import, then we're doing what? We're giving to our children the resources they need in order to survive in this life. And the last thing I want to say is, because I just got back here from Africa, and I've been in the last 6 months, I've been in Mozambique, I've been in Ethiopia, and I've been in Kenya. And I've had the opportunity to know what it means to be a black man in America. And I can tell you that when we look at where we are compared to where other people are, we in this room are truly blessed, because the lights didn't go out while you were in here, and the water we're drinking is clearly digestible. But some of our brothers and sisters on the face of this earth are struggling even more than we are. Now, that doesn't make our lives any less and make it any easier to face the burdens we face, but certainly we must understand that life in and of itself is not easy. It is a struggle. It is a constant struggle to do, first of all, the right things ourselves. And we have judges that have problems paying their child support. So I don't want you to think that. And I'm not one of them. But I think it's important at this juncture that someone say that it is the values that we have that you have heard people wrestling with. And you've heard these great panelists talk to you about the values they have. All of them value the life of their children. And if you value the life of your children, then you must tell your children that they have to be careful in the selection, and let's call it what it is, of their mates. But these are not permanent mates. They're sexual partners oftentimes, that because of that sexual partnership, there's been a memorialization, and that memorialization is in the form of a new life. That's what we have many times. You can't be a family with a woman you met or a man you met last night that you didn't know the day before, but you and that person are fathering or parenting children. It just isn't going to happen because there's no foundation. And that's where we as a community must recognize that we've got to live at a higher standard, and that's why I was referring to Africa. The standard we have is that we have the resources to elect whether or not we're going to have children with particular people, because all over Africa they got signs, I can tell you, they say wrap it up, and the thing they're talking about wrapping up is the penis, because there the problems is are AIDS and HIV, and in those societies over there as much as 38% or 40% of the population is infected. So it's a true problem. But here, our problem is not so much AIDS, but the persons we elect to have sexual relationships with. And maybe we better go back to some fundamental values, such as what? You must tell your children that sex is a serious thing and is not to be played with, because you can make a new life, and you may be tied for 18 years in our courts, but for a lifetime in the life of your child. And that's all I want to say.
Okay, let's give Judge a round of applause. Thank you.